guaranteed. Visit arnoldclark.com.
Welcome to Peter and Roughie's Football Show, sponsored by Arnold Clark. Wednesday, the 26th of August. We don't hang about on this programme. When there's money available, we go out there and we push it for the best talent. But suddenly, when we hear the words free transfer, no money required, then we go out and get the best talent as well. And that has to be messy. We had to sign him, Roughie. There's no point in hanging about. Tam wanted the best, and he's available.
Yeah, and it obviously, the first thing that came out of his mouth was it was always the company he wanted to come to. You know, it was his dream. So, I mean, there's nothing you can say. As you do, you just have to get him.
You have to go and get him. Yeah, so even would you be good at tiki-taka football, Tam?
Yes, I think I could play with Messi. I think he would even get me to score a few more goals.
Yeah, absolutely. Listen, great to have you on board today. Of course, it's Wednesday, so Charlie is with us, and we will replace Messi for Charlie. Some people say they've got the same wand of a left foot, to be perfectly honest with you. So only time will tell. Charlie Adam with us, Tam McManus and Alan Ruff. You can like, share and follow us on our Facebook and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thanks for joining us in the football family, because the figures are in and we are getting great figures of people just joining us all the time. And I've had a look at the special competition coming up over the next couple of weeks, and I know Tam and Charlie will love it, and I'm going to try to the best of my ability to get Charlie up to take part in this competition, because I think it's going to be fantastic, and Ruffy as well. Lots of people joining us. Hi, Stuart Ramsey from sunny West Midlands. John Aird, Mick McNamee's in Cumbernauld. Hi from Cyprus, Mark Hughes. Keep up the good work, guys. Thank you for that, Mark. George Mather as well, and he thinks that Messi's going to join his favourite club. Alan Brotherson's in Sydney, Australia, and Patrick Glacken is in Bulgaria. I don't think we've had Bulgaria on the show. That could be a first for us, Bulgaria. New Jersey's where John Murphy is, and David McCauley is in Auckland. That gives you an indication of the huge following we've got here at home, and also what's happening away right across the globe. So many people joining us. Hi to Patrick McMenamin and also Tommy Adams, who's in Thailand at the moment, as we and Charlie might not know.
Peter,
Ruffy's favourite venue.
Peter, oh, Charlie's not got the same iPods I did on Monday.
Oh, Charlie's actually have the original Apple design on them, not the one that was drawn on an East Kilbride that you bought, you know, because I noticed you were getting pelters from it. Listen, there's lots to talk about. I can just tell you, some kind of a news just breaking. We'll probably firm it up over the next couple of hours. Of course, that Martin Boyle on the verge of maybe signing a new 2-year deal at Hibernian, which, Tam, that would be fantastic.
Yeah, I'd be surprised, to be honest, if he signed a new deal. Listen, Martin's, I think, 27 years old, probably his last chance of a big move, and it'd be fantastic business if Hibs can get him tied down for 2 years. I mean, a lot of clubs linked to him. I think Celtic have been linked to him for a number of years, obviously, with Neil Lennon been there. But if Hibs can get him to sign a new deal, I think he's happy there. His wife plays for Hibs Ladies, so they're very settled, and hopefully we can keep him.
We will give you more on that story as it evolves over the next couple of hours. Now, I have to say to you that the burning issue of fans being allowed into football grounds, we'll be talking about that. We'll hear from Neil Lennon ahead of tonight's match against Ferencvaros. We'll hear from Stephen Robinson. Of course, Aberdeen and Mother will get two big games coming up in the Europa League. So there's lots to talk about. Rangers as well, Michael Beale tipping someone to give James Tavernier a run for his money. Give us your thoughts on your favourite team. Don't just wait for us to dictate what to talk about. If you want to get into something, we'll also discuss Harry Maguire and Kieran Tierney as well. Where's he going to play for Scotland? All that to come. Of course, the biggest news right across the globe, and we are a football show, so we like to deal with it, is, of course, Lionel Messi. It set the Twitter and it set all the social media alight when apparently he delivered a post office fax, which means that it can be determined when it arrives and if the club has received it, basically saying he wanted to leave Barcelona. Here's a wee insight into the wonderful Lionel Messi.
Lionel Messi has asked to leave Barcelona, giving us a chance to look back at his career. The now 33-year-old Argentine became the youngest player to play and score for Barca back in 2004. Before he became the focal point of the team, he led them to two Champions Leagues in 2009 and 2011. A year later, he scored a record 91 goals in a calendar year, and in 2015, Barca did the treble again with the iconic MSN trio up front. However, things did not go so well with Argentina, where he's still yet to win a major trophy. Last year, he was back to his best, winning his sixth Ballon d'Or, but this season ended in the humiliation of an 8-2 defeat to Bayern Munich. And if he does leave, where will Messi end up?
Charlie Adam, everybody and their granny is saying it'll end up at their favourite club, but there's no doubt about it. He will be a hot property.
Absolutely. And the only thing for Messi is it's where he decides to go. Clubs could want him, but it's his decision. He can go to any club in the world. And for me, I think Man City would be the only option. But also, I think it's a bit of cat and mouse as well with the president and everything that's going on at Barcelona. And no, I wouldn't be surprised if he actually stayed. And the president and everybody, the directors, move on and there's a new election brought forward.
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting game of chess here, Roughie, because he reckons he can get out because there is a clause in the contract. They say the clause date has passed and anybody that wants him might have to play as high as 700 million euros. I don't think anybody in their right mind would play that for a 33-year-old, even though he's possibly got the build, Roughie, that he could play for, what, 5, 6, 7 years more?
Yeah, but it's, as Charlie said there, you know, the limits to the teams that can afford them. I would say it would have to be a team heavily linked with the Arab connection who do have that kind of money. But whether they'd be prepared to spend the whole lot, I don't know. But we'll have to wait and see because Messi himself, there's reports that he's just not going to turn up. You know, so that's another dilemma, you know, if he doesn't turn up for the training. So they have got a massive problem and it's, if he decides he's going to go, then there's nothing they can do about it.
Yeah, you mentioned the Arab connection. Will I include Dundee United in that, or are you just ruling them completely out, Roughie?
No, I don't think they're. I don't think they're big enough Arabs.
Okay. Just on a
Peter. Peter, it's amazing that they always say the old saying that no one's bigger than the club. You think Messi's bigger than Barcelona?
Well, the funny thing is, Tam, here's the point, and Charlie just touched on it there about, you know, this game of tit for tat that's going on at the moment. The clearly, the way the board, with Eric Abidal, and the way they've, you know, dealt with the players, the way they've handled certain situations, their signing policy, the whole thing has been a catastrophe, and it's just gone gradually downwards. I mean, remember, this is a side who've reached the semi-finals of the Champions League, but the difference now is he's had enough, he wants to go, and he wants to go somewhere where he can finish his career on a high, Tam, but that's the nature of that level. I mean, if Charlie joins a club like Liverpool, Charlie would be absolutely desperate to give his all and do the best he possibly can and just get his head down and work like mad, you know. But suddenly these guys have a say. They want to know what's happening. They want to know what direction the club's going. I mean, it's crazy, Tam.
Yeah, as I mean, there was obviously the clause that he can walk away for nothing. And if somebody's getting him in a free, obviously he's going to have to pay his wages. But, you know, I think somebody said last night, how many jerseys would you sign if you signed Messi, if Man City signed Messi? They would get their wages back in 2 months with jerseys and stuff like that.
Somebody told me these reports. Everybody's saying he's on £1 million a week net. That's £100 million a year. £100 million in wages a year. So for them, it's a no-brainer. Man City are probably the only ones. PSG, but why would you want to go to PSG? Playing a league it's a good league, but you know Paris have dominated for a number of years. Man City is a different type of competition.
Yeah, I think you're right on that point, Charlie. I mean, I'd love to see him play in English football. I mean, I like watching the Premier League. Not all of it, but I like watching a lot of it. You know, obviously from my own point of view, since I was a boy, a big Liverpool fan. So I like watching the Premier League. But Roughie, the talk about 100 million that Charlie's mentioned there, this boy has been worth every penny they've paid him so far. His stats are just mind-blowing.
Yeah, it is, and we touched on the money there. And as I say, I go back to the Arab oil billionaires, you know, that kind of money's nothing to them. That's maybe 2 or 3 months of the royal stuff, you know. That's pennies, you know. They'll look at that and
Dubai and the Qataris, they're not splashing the money that you would think at the moment. They're pulling the money at the horse racing, which is massive for them. And there's other avenues. Obviously, Sheikh Mansour is a huge common denominator at Man City, but I don't think it's just as simple as he would sign for Man City. Do you know what I mean? For the money. But
yeah.
What a way to stick it up to UEFA if they do.
Yeah, absolutely. Another thing about it as well is, I don't know, Charlie's clearly not aware of it, Tam, but Roughie offers all sorts of information on the price of oil and how much you get for barrels. Well, I was just about to say that. You know, that hundred million is actually only 2 or 3 months' money to them. I'm thinking, where did he pluck that figure from? Yeah. What do you know about oil?
Because it's £1.25 at Esso.
Yeah.
A gallon.
There are other oil companies as well.
Well,
Morris said another plug.
No, but Charlie never forgets his roots. That's it. He's just given us the insight into where you can get cheaper petrol. Yeah, Roughie talking about oil and the barrels and how much they go for. I'm chucking it completely if he continues down this way. But nevertheless, listen, where could he go? Here are the options from our reporter, Gabriel Antoniazzi.
Lionel Messi hoping for a move away from Barcelona after nearly 2 decades at the club, where could he go? Manchester City are favourites to sign him and have tried before, with Messi of course keen on a reunion with Pep Guardiola. Keep an eye on this one. Manchester United make no secret of their riches and have also registered interest, whilst Adidas, Messi and United's sponsor, are very keen to unite the two brands together. The same could be said for Adidas made by Munich, who are one of the few clubs who could afford him. But would the Argentine fit in with the new European champions? Paris Saint-Germain have always wanted to sign the biggest names in the world. Messi could potentially line up alongside former teammate Neymar and Kylian Mbappe in a frightening front line. Inter Milan are the least likely to grab a signature, but owner Steven Zhang wants to make a statement signing, which could see old foes Messi and Cristiano Ronaldo face off once again in Serie A. The other options are moves to America or China, or perhaps even a romantic reunion of two hometown club Newell's old boys. But with Messi still at the top of his powers, he is expected to be playing in the Champions League next season.
Yeah, interesting stuff. All the options. Can't see him going to America, to be perfectly honest with you. And as you know, on our Facebook, everybody reacts to certain points that everybody highlights. Lindsay Buchanan says, no, it's £1.13 at Asda, Tam. That's everybody now jumping on the bandwagon with you, you idiot. And now people are telling us, Jim Torrance says, tell Tam it's £1.20 a litre, not a gallon. That's £9. You see where this programme goes? It's madness. But to be perfectly honest with you, and thank you to Tommy, who's in Thailand. He says the reason why everybody across the world is tuning into the programme is because the telly's rotten where we are. So I'm not quite sure if Tommy's paying us a compliment or the fact that the telly is rotten in Thailand. Who knows? Nevertheless, Messi, it's all a gamble on this. I think I don't even go there. Honestly,
who watches the telly in Thailand?
8 years with.
Why is he watching the telly? Does he not go out?
he can go watch a show.
Exactly. Can I just say, shut up, YouTube. Anyway, apart from anything else, Tommy, we're delighted you're with us. That's the first thing. Who knows? I think he'll go Man City. Where do you think, Tam?
I think he'll go to Man City as well. I agree with Charlie. Yeah. I think they're the only club that can afford them.
Yeah. Would you say, are you saying Man City, Charlie?
No, I'm saying stay at Barcelona and get the president out.
All right, good call. Roughie?
I'm saying Man City, but not just because Man City. I think it's the English League. I think it'd be great for him to come here and prove to, if there is any doubters out there, you know, that he still can perform at that level.
Yeah, I think Man City, only for the fact that the whole Barcelona structure that was there before, those executives are now at Manchester City, operating there. Pep's there. David Silva's gone. What a replacement that would be for Man City. I still wouldn't buy a Man City top, though.
Can you imagine Messi sitting in Manchester, isolating for quarantining for 2 weeks in a hotel?
Yeah, okay. By the way, I have to say to you, I mean, I watched the documentary on it. Manchester as a city is just going like that. I mean, it's booming as far as business is concerned. The media world has gone to there. It's a real hub of media outlets as well. And I think a lot of people who live in Manchester are realising the value of the property is soaring. So you never know. You never know. He might not be used to the rain that's there on a perpetual basis, but who knows? Messi, the talk of the world. We like to deal with everything on the football show, and that's certainly been a hot topic. Another bit of news that's just breaking. I might as well get your thoughts on it, guys, because it was turning into almost a class argument within football, the fact that the government denied Celtic the opportunity to have 700 fans in for the Motherwell game. This on the back of Glasgow and Edinburgh playing in front of what we think will be 1,000 fans at rugby on Friday night. So is it one rule for one and one rule for another? There was all sorts of speculation on this, but there's the government on denying fans at Celtic Park says a lot of work has gone on behind the scenes during these past months to create the protocols and testing regimes to allow top-level professional sport in Scotland to resume without putting the public or others at unnecessary risk. We recognise there is disappointment that the proposal for a pilot on the 30th of August has not been approved, but we are looking for suitable alternative dates for football pilots. We need to allow sufficient time for any test events to be informed by learning from other events, in particular the rugby match at Murrayfield on the 28th of August. So that's the official line that's coming from the government. I'll be honest with you, I don't think that cuts with a lot of football fans, to be honest with you, Tam. I think a number of them might have this underlying sense that the government is trying to tread carefully, not to upset the Celtic and Rangers power base by allowing Celtic to get these fans in first. That could be one of the things that goes on in the background, in the pettiness of Scottish football.
Yeah, I think you're right. I mean, a lot of Rangers fans are complaining about why is Celtic getting being the first to pilot it and different things. And you know what it's like in the west of Scotland, Peter. You know, they'll moan about it. The rugby, in terms of the rugby, listen, I'm glad there's people going into the rugby games, but I don't understand why you can get people into rugby, into Murrayfield, and can't get people into Celtic Park or Ibrox at the same time. So I don't understand it, Peter. And football people have got every right to be upset about it and be asking a lot of questions, to be honest.
Yeah, I mean, it does have that feel. I'm sure it will be twisted, Charlie. Let me put it this way. It will be twisted to make it a class thing. You know, are people who watch rugby, you know, far more educated and likely to behave themselves than people who watch football? Because it seems to be that one rule for one for the other.
Yeah, listen, there'll be a lot of different factors. Definitely, you know, whatever way they went, the opposite side would have been complaining. But also, I think that the misdemeanours that the Aberdeen lads and the Celtic lads, it's probably gone against football as well. That would not have helped them. But you know, at least we're moving in the right direction. You know, rugby's getting an opportunity, and good luck to them. I hope it is successful, and then we can move on to the next stage in football, and hopefully in the next few weeks, supporters will be getting into stadiums.
Yeah, slowly but surely. I mean, I've been watching some old games, Roughie. You know, they show the classic Premier League games on Sky. You're looking at them and you're seeing the fans and you're thinking to yourself, God, that seems such a long time ago, you know, getting 16, 70,000 into grounds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it does. And I think we saw the evidence that we do need fans in the stadiums. So we need it because, you know, some of the games have been a wee bit dire. And I think fans in there adding a bit of spectacle to the game make it a wee bit better. So we can definitely see how much it affects the fans. A large crowd at a game can make to any game at all. So, yeah, sooner it is. I hope they're using the rugby one as a tester, you know, because something might go wrong in that rugby one. You know, just a wee hiccup somewhere. And if they're allowing the Celtic one 2 days later, I'm hoping that the health people are just giving themselves a bit of breathing space, that hopefully nothing does go wrong, and they can build it for there.
Yeah, what do you mean by going wrong, Ruffy? You mean somebody contracts coronavirus?
Yeah, it's a test, isn't it? I mean, they're allowing, I think it's 1,000 in. There might be a wee hiccup they haven't really identified. Maybe something just comes up, and then all of a sudden they have to redirect what they're doing. I just, the 2 days, I don't think is enough breathing space if there was any kind of wee hiccup.
Yeah. Well, to be fairly honest with you, it's an interesting one to see how it all pans out. I certainly hope it's a success. The elements of it that I think are risk is, you know, any fans, you know, shouting without a mask on, singing without a mask on. I certainly won't get that at the rugby. And going up to the ground is another case of will people take into consideration the social distancing on this and pay attention to it and be vigilant with it as well. There's all sorts of things like that. And of course, you're touching surfaces. All these things come into play. This disease is crazy. You can't draft it. You don't know where at times it's going to get to. But let's hope it's a success. As Charlie says, we're moving in the right direction, hopefully. Okay, to the football in Scotland that's actually going to take place. Celtic are in action against Ferencváros of Hungary. And Neil Lennon says this is a step up again.
You know, physically, athletically, tactically, you know, quality-wise, you know, Ferencváros are a big step up. And like I said, you know, they negotiated the tie against Djurgården very comfortably, and that wasn't an easy thing to do. And, you know, looking at the Europa League results last season, they never lost a game away from home in the group to, you know, Espanyol, Ludogorets, CSKA Moscow. So they know how to travel. So that's what lies ahead of us. It's going to be a difficult tie.
Yeah, I mean, with that in mind, Roughie, this is a game where everybody always looks at the qualifiers and thinks there's a big 30, 40 million pound kitty at the end of it if you get to the group stages. I mean, it's absolutely crucial in some cases to try and get there because of the riches that await.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it certainly is. But as Lenny said there, this team have got a wee bit of CV away from home. That will be a worry. My biggest worry about the whole tie tonight is no fans in the stadium. I think we all know what it's like in a Champions League night at Parkhead, 50, 60,000 supporters there. Opposition must feel a wee bit intimidated. That's not going to be the case tonight. I spoke about it last night. I think they'll be very relaxed coming here knowing that there isn't 50,000 people breathing down their neck. So that's something Celtic will have to go over. But I'm sure if the big players turn up on the night, they should win this one.
Yeah, as far as Callum McGregor is concerned, he says that the side are well prepared for this second round qualifier.
Yeah, I think when you get to this stage, then you know you kind of get past the first round, and then you know you start to come across some serious teams. And I think you know their record, obviously last year in the Europa League was excellent as well. So you know there's no chance of us underestimating them or you know underpreparing or anything like that. So as I said, we've prepared well, we trained well this morning, and you know, we're looking forward to the game.
There's a wee edge to it, Charlie, this kind of a one-off tie. It's you're on a knife edge, you can't have any slip-ups.
No, you know, these are a dangerous team. You know, they've got two big lads at the back, Blazic and Sivic, who are, you know, strong defenders, a bit of pace up front. So Celtic will need to be wary tonight, and, you know, the pressure's on Celtic to get into the next round and get into that. But the four games to get to the Champions League is crucifying for these Scottish clubs at the moment. And say if they can get through that, then you know it'll be a tasty tie in the next round.
Yeah, but that point alone, Charlie, is a real bugbear up here because next year there'll be two spaces available. They'll still have to go through qualifiers. And I mention a name every year on this programme, but I am no fan of Karl-Heinz Rummenigge because if he had his way, they'd have the top five countries in the world all just playing each other and everybody else can take a running jump.
Yeah, I mean, that's the powers of the UEFA and the big clubs are always they want to look after themselves. But, you know, the Rangers and Celtic in the last few years have done extremely well in European competition, so they deserve that opportunity. Next season they'll have two, but they'll still have to go through the qualifiers and it's going to be tough for them. But, you know, Celtic can get through tonight and set themselves up for a tie in the next month, and it'll be interesting to see how they get on.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to this one, Tam. It's going to be certainly a step up from the last one. We all know that, but I wonder what way they're going to play. I think this one-off tie kind of negates teams sitting in the home leg now. They just think to themselves, well, it's a hit. We're going to have to go for it.
Yeah, you've not seen many nil-nils, Peter, in any of the games, the one-off games. You know, both teams are going after it. You know, there's no second leg, there's no second chances. You know, as Charlie said, this is a dangerous team. You know, they've got a good record in Europe. They comfortably beat the Swedish champions in the last round. So, listen, Celtic will need to be at it tonight. They'll need to play well to get through the next round. And there's no second chances. You know, if you have an off night, or you defend poorly, then you're out of the competition. So Celtic need to be, you know, concentrated. And it'll be interesting to see if Ajeti plays. You know, he might come in, you might bring him in and play him up front with Edouard and change the shape a little bit. Maybe play 3-5-2. So I think Celtic will go two strikers tonight, Peter.
Yeah, he didn't train.
Good thing about Celtic is they've had more game time than this than Ferencvaros, so they should be up to speed a lot quicker than what these are, and they need to just come out the blocks flying.
Yeah, I mean, I wonder if Edouard's okay. Slight niggle. You always worry about that, Roughie, if he's not going to take to the field, because he's the type of player that can make the difference in these games.
Yeah, he's a big-time player. We saw him coming up with the big-time goals. But I still agree with Tam. I think it would take the pressure off him a wee bit if he had another goal scorer up there with him, and to do that, they've got enough abundance in midfield to push an extra man forward. I don't think they should be playing with sitting midfielders at home in this one-legged game. I think they should go for it, let them know they're in a game. But interesting when the team selection comes out, because Lennon has been known to throw in a wee surprise here and there. And but I certainly would like to see two strikers playing tonight.
Yeah, give us your prediction, Roughie.
I think it'll be 2-1 Celtic.
Okay, Charlie?
2-0 Celtic, comfortable.
Tam?
I'm going to go for 3-2 to Celtic.
3-2 to Celtic, oof, that's a nail-biter. Yeah. And to be fair, who are we to argue with you, Tam? Because on the predictor, you've been absolutely on fire at the moment, texting all your mates and saying how well you're doing and how well you know football. So it's going to be fantastic. You've had it your own way too long, Peter.
You've had it all your own way too long, son.
I can't wait.
I'm just kidding, block.
Oh, that's fun. You've come out, honestly, you've come out like the 5,000 metres out of the traps, running away there, but slowly but surely we'll peg you.
You never told him, Peter, you get 15 points for a correct European score.
wouldn't that be great? Anyway, listen, Charlie, I don't think we've spoken to you since Friday, obviously, and of course the developments at Rangers. It's an ongoing situation with Morelos. He's never far away from our thoughts on this program. I think over the last 2 years, almost regularly in the week, we are talking about Alfredo Morelos. Steven Gerrard's now come out and said, look, I didn't pick him in the squad at the weekend because he wasn't up to it. And now you're in a situation where you're looking and you're saying Ryan Kent says he wants to stay with Rangers. You know, I call it the squeaky bum time when it gets closer to October, Charlie, when people think, I hope they don't sign a player and take him away before you've got the chance to regroup and get players in off the back of it.
No, I think that there's a different mentality in the players there. Like I said before, I would have been, Morelos would never have played at Aberdeen if they had Roof and Aiton in before that, because of the shape and his fitness that he come back, the club were obviously weren't happy about. And that was a perfect opportunity to go and drop him at home. It's obviously they've went and won the game, so it doesn't look like you'll play the next game. So you know, it'll be interesting now to see where Rangers are, if they're trying to really push this deal through and get some money in. The Kent one is, you know, if the lad has come out and said he doesn't want to go anywhere, that's a massive boost for the club. But I still believe that Leeds will come in and give, you know, 15 plus for him. And it'll be a big decision for the club. Do they want to take the money and run? Or do they feel that the Ryan Kent's best place to stay at Rangers for another season?
Yeah, I mean, the good thing about it, Charlie, is we were talking about it a year ago about the fact that they needed to try and get a settled defence. It looks as if, on the evidence, and you only can deal with the stats here, they're not losing goals. So they've got a formation now that they're sticking to, rigidly keeping teams from scoring goals from domestically.
Yeah, the biggest problem Rangers have had since Steven Gerrard's come in is the lesser games, as you would say. Your Livingston's away, Kilmarnock's away, trying to break these teams down on the AstroTurf. They've been difficult games for them, so they need to find a solution on how they do it. And there's no doubt about Rangers defensively. Now, Hollander's coming back in, who's a good defender. Balogun done really well until he got his injury. So defensively, they're solid, but it's always that, you know, team against Rangers that sit in, they have to try and find a solution and, you know, different options up front or wide.
Yeah, breaking news says that Andy Croy's a big Rangers fan. He says there's a swap deal, Morelos to Barcelona, Messi to Rangers. Yeah, I love the actual headline. I don't know if you spotted it, Tam, on Glasgow Live yesterday, which was former Rangers target Messi wants to leave Barcelona, and I thought, wow, now that's a thin link.
That is a clickbait link if ever I've seen one. I actually read that Alec McLeish, was it not that somebody had told him about this young kid for Barcelona on Championship Manager? Is that true?
Well, I know Alec would have been desperate. I think everybody was talking about him as a youngster because you only have to look at Charlie Lamasia, the training camp and the academy at Barcelona. Yeah. They were filming him week in, week out, beating players for fun and scoring goals. So, you know, Alex probably heard and thought, we'll take him. You know, we'll give him 2 years of football before you take him back. I wouldn't have ruled that out with Alec at that point.
No, definitely not. And I know sorry, Tam.
There you go, Charlie.
Yeah, no, I think I was around the club at that time. When that come out, but no, you know, Alec, everybody does that. It wouldn't surprise me if he'd made the call and tried to get him because, you know, he would have known about him with the scouts and things like that. But, you know, Barcelona invested so much money into him as a youngster, you know, and trying to help him grow and things like that. But what a player he's been, isn't he?
Yeah, and funnily enough, at that round about that time, Charlie, you're probably better placed than most. I don't know if you played in the games against Lyon, but I can remember Rangers playing Lyon, and they had a youngster in there, and I think he was about 17 or 18 at the time, in the first team, scoring goals. And you looked at him and you thought to yourself, I always remember three players that stuck in my mind. Obviously, Messi, when he was wearing the number 19 shirt. The second one was Benzema, who played for Lyon against Rangers, and he was unbelievable. And the third one was, of course, Scotland played Croatia at Hampden, and there was a wee guy in the middle of the park who absolutely bossed the game, and he turned out to be Luka Modric.
I was on the bench that night, the two games in the Champions League. Was it when Benzema scored a hat-trick at Ibrox?
Yeah.
You know, the Rangers beat them over there. Daniel Kuzan scored, and they had the playmaker, Janinho, at the time, didn't they?
Yes, and, number eight.
Yeah, and obviously we'd won the game 3-0 over there, and we thought, well, we'll beat these, we'll qualify for the Champions League, for the next stage of the Champions League. And then Benzema scored a hat-trick at Ibrox, and it was, you know, that was the run for Europa League, wasn't it?
Yeah, I was trying to think of the boy, Jean-Claude Darcheville. Do you remember him, Charlie?
Yeah, I played with him. He's the only guy I know that done a pre-season on a bike. The guy did not want to run. It was unbelievable, but Walter allowed him to have it. You know, he was the same situation as Morelos. Not the fittest, didn't really want to run around, but get him in front of goal, he could score goals, and he was a good, very good player.
Yeah, doesn't want to run around. My type of player. I like him already.
Pierre.
Yeah.
What number was Darcheville? You seem to be good with the numbers of the players. What number was he, Darcheville?
What number? Jean-Claude Darcheville. Oh, I think he was a high number, but I remember him well at that time because I was over commentating on that game. Was he 19?
19.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Put that on your files, Peter.
I'll stick that down, Jean-Claude Darcheville. Where are they now? We must do a feature on that. Where are they now? That would be an absolute raker. They used to do that in the Sunday Post, Roughie, remember? Where are they now from the 70s? The players. Alan Ruff is currently working for Real Radio.
Thailand.
Yes, yeah. In Thailand, yeah. Live.
That's his dream gig.
Kenny Whitson has actually got it down to a T the way this program's going. He says, whatever you do, don't ask Ruffy to say Jean-Claude Darcheville because that could just end up to be an absolute catastrophe. He can't. Greg Hamilton says Dashville was decent. It was. He scored a few decent goals, to be perfectly honest with you. The other thing I was going to get your thoughts on, guys, Tam, Michael Beale is saying to James Tavernier, listen, young Nathan Patterson, come on as a sub for you. Mm-hmm. That's the type of player. He's hungry. You know, there's going to be a little bit of competition. You need competition in various areas across the field. And they've got high hopes for this young man.
Yeah, they have, and I think Tavernier has obviously been nailed on. He's the captain of the club. He's been his place has been secured for a number of years now. But it's great that this young lad's coming through Patterson, and obviously rate him very highly at Rangers, and he's going to push Tavernier because you can only get better as a player. And Charlie will tell you as well that somebody's snapping at your heels to get in to your place, and it makes you concentrate and makes you play better because you know if you have an off day or a couple of bad games, you're out of the team. So. Yeah, I think that's good. That's good for Rangers as a club. You know that Patterson's coming through and he's pressurising the captain of the club. So he must be doing really well in training as well. And Gerrard, I think, rates him highly.
Well done to Connor Cumming, who says, Darshaville, he was no Mo Bangura. There's another name. The next Henrik Larsson was how he was billed. There's nothing worse than
from
somebody
his agent.
Giving you... Oh, well, that's exactly it. There's nothing worse than somebody building you up to a situation where you're never going to be able to get to the same height. Listen, Charlie, what did you make of the Scotland squad? Gordon Strachan said today that he reckons Tierney can play left centre-back or right-back. I mean, I've spoken to Steve Clark over a year ago. We've been discussing this, and I said, Steve Clark doesn't... Kieran Tierney doesn't want to play right-back. He just doesn't want to play there. But he will play left centre-back.
Absolutely. And I was looking at the squad earlier, and I was just trying to see what the team would probably be in. What I would pick, but I would go 4-3-3 and get Tierney's playing as left centre back. You know, my only issue is then, do you play two left centre side centre backs together? Liam Cooper for me has been excellent for Leeds and deserves an opportunity to play. And will he play Kieran Tierney beside them? And that's the only issue I think that they have. I think the rest picks itself. I'd play Palmer at right back, and then that would be it.
Tam.
Yeah, Charlie's thrown a few names in there. You know, Cooper, obviously, Charlie's down south and he sees these guys obviously more regular than us. And I think the competition for places in midfield is unbelievable. You look at your three in there. I mean, Charlie, who would your three midfielders be in your 4-3-3?
I'd go Jack, Cal McGregor and John McGinn. And I'd play Christie off the half and half, off the left. I think Robertson loves somebody in front of him. And if Christie can come and play in the pitch a little bit and allow Robertson to go on the outside, I think that would suit Scotland a little bit. And Forrest would play up on the right for me.
Ruffy, he's got choices now. That's the key to it all now. He's got options. Yeah. I mean, Nations League, again, Israel just seems to be the team that we're playing all the time at the moment. But he's got a couple of games here where he can start to get a real feel for who's going to be playing. Lyndon Dykes suddenly gives him another option.
Mm-hmm. No, I agree with Charlie and Tam. I think particularly at home, we should be playing as many attacking avenues as possible. We've certainly got people that can play at Hampden that would terrify, I would think, visiting sides. Away from home, I'm not too sure. We haven't proven myself away from home that defensively we can be strong with a three. So it's something you can work on. But let's get the first game out the road. Let's go and win the Israel one. And certainly with the more attacking players, more chances. If we're not going to score goals for up front, let's score them for midfield. We've seen John McGinn getting in there. You know, he's quite prepared to be in the 18-yard box and about and getting goals. So, I'm all for it.
Yep, okay. Give us your thoughts on it. Who would you like to see start for Scotland? Of course, we mentioned Kieran Tierney there. No surprise, the national manager is a huge fan.
Yeah, also met Kieran in March before the games were cancelled, obviously. We had a good conversation and chat. Very honest, at that time, Kieran was still recovering from his injuries, but was starting to get through the other side. He hasn't had or he didn't have the best of starts at Arsenal, injury-wise. But he did okay when he got in the team, broke in the team. Made a lot of people sit up and take notice that he's a good player, but we knew that anyway.
Yeah, so it's going to be interesting to see where he eventually plays him. But no doubt about it, he's got good options there. Give us your thoughts on that as well. Mark posted there on our Facebook, he remembers a young Robert Prozineski absolutely battering us as well. Prozineski, I mean, I don't know about you, Tam, maybe a wee bit. But I don't know if you were old enough to remember him.
No, but I remember him.
You do remember him? I mean, Charlie, Sir Bobby Robson said to me one day trackside, he was manager of Barcelona in a friendly match over in Scotland. He said, 100 fags a day, he said, son, 100 fags a day. And by the way, Prozineki, absolutely magnificent.
Amazing. You know, we talk about, I seen the other day about Hector Bellerin smoking a fag the other day on holiday. Listen, that happens. It's in every dressing room, lads are having a fag. It's not an issue. You know, lads were having fags 10, 15 years ago in the toilet at half time. So it's not going to change anything. But these lads, like you say, 100 fags, they wouldn't have surprised me. He was the best player on the pitch.
Yeah, well, Cruyff was like that as well. And then he just completely stopped Roughie. Of course, Roughie, the most famous one of all, I think. And I think, correct me if I'm wrong on this, guys, but I think I remember it was I was covering the match, which was Hearts against Rangers in the League Cup. It was at Celtic Park. And at half-time, I think Gascoigne went into the executive suite, ordered a couple of brandies or whiskies, downed the two of them, came out the second half, and absolutely destroyed Hearts and won the game for Rangers.
Yeah, but there's lots of players like that. I mean, we'll even talk about Socrates in Brazil. When we played Brazil in Seville, you know, actually in the tunnel, he had a cigarette. But the rest of the Brazil team were all smoking as well. So it was just one of these things.
Did you feel at that point? Did you
I think Roughie was smoking point? Weed that night.
Yeah. Exactly.
I was just about to say, Roughie, did you feel when you saw them smoking that you thought we got them?
Yeah, see, I'll put that out for God's sake. I can't see what's in front of me.
There had to be a reason, to be fair. Socrates was also very famous as well for just basically saying to the Brazilian management and the authorities there that the ban on sex before games, he wasn't adhering to it either. That was something that a number of people didn't want to bring the wives over, didn't want to distract them. Some countries did that and obviously tried to tell the big man, look, there'll be no hanky-panky before the games, but Socrates stood his ground and, you know, whatever happened to him, Tam, you know, how good was he? He was magnificent.
Roughie talks about him every show, so I'm not really seeing him, but I'm assuming he was unbelievable.
Yeah, oh, he was sensational. What a player he was. The best.
Roughie, did you have that ban? Did you have this no sex before a game ban? Did you ever adhere to that?
Never even came into my mind.
No, exactly.
Never even came into my mind.
You were focused on the game, Roughie. That's exactly it. You don't go to three World Cups.
That's
you don't go to three World Cups and be married to Miss Scotland and think about anything other than football. Anyway, so with that in mind,
Don't ask me about after the game, but.
Yeah, absolutely. David Palfreman says Roughie was on cigars in 1971. Roughie must have been on cigars or something because even Roughie at 4-0 up for Partick Thistle in the League Cup final was looking and wondering if he was in a dream. It was magnificent. Interestingly enough, the Aaron Hickey, two players in Scotland that I think have got a future to be decided and we're following it closely. I don't think there's any doubt. We're going to hear from Stephen Robinson shortly on one of them. But the other one is Aaron Hickey, who's got a decision to make. There was a wee sniff of Celtic, Tam, but I don't know. Now there's a suggestion they might want to go to Bologna. But Bayern Munich still, I think, have been schmoozing him and getting him over and letting him see the Allianz Arena and thinking, you could be part of this.
Yeah, listen, I think if Bayern Munich are serious about their interest, and I believe they are, then I don't think there's any other club he should be looking to go to. I mean, what an education he would get in Germany. You know, I think he'd be going playing their B team in the third division and get a great education. And Alfonso Davies, obviously, in front of him as a guy who he can mould his game on and look at him and try and emulate what he's done because he's probably the best left-back in the world just now. So, great young player, you know, and Hearts will be looking for a big fee for him. You know, Hearts have really took a kicking over the summer. They've lost a lot of money with getting relegated. So, if they can get a couple of £1 million in, they'll be delighted by that. I'll set them forward for the new campaign.
Yeah, of course, Scottish players going to play in Germany. There's been a few successes. Murdo McLeod, Borussia Dortmund as well. And of course, Mark McGee at Hamburg before he returned to play in Scottish football. And then another one was Alan McAnally at Bayern Munich, just in case anybody didn't know about it. And over and above that, Scott Booth at Borussia Dortmund. And here's a cracker for you, had you remembered this one. Mark Fotheringham at SC Freiburg was another player who'd played in the Bundesliga. And Ollie Burke, one of the Scottish internationalists, RB Leipzig. So there's a few who played. And David Bates, Rangers youngster who went over to Hamburg to play in the Bundesliga. I'm not quite sure. I don't know at this point if you could actually hear if that was supposed to have music on it. It was just me talking over it. But nevertheless, there was a few. Could you hear me talking about that there, Tam?
We couldn't hear Gavin.
No, well, of course, because his name's Gabriel. Roughie calls our reporter Gabriel, Gavin, but nevertheless.
I can't believe who left it, Brian O'Neill.
Yeah, Brad, well, I said it was a selection of some of them. There's actually quite a lot of players. Vince Menny was another player who played for Dundee, Charlie, and Kevin went over Kerr. To play for Cologne, Kevin Kerr. There's lots of people. We just thought we'd put in a few of them. I'm wondering if Scott Booth would have been considered a success at Borussia Dortmund. I know he struggled to get in that side at times, but nevertheless... not all of them would have been successes. We just thought to give you a little flavour of it. But hopefully Aaron Hickey, if he does decide, he can make a success of it, because I think he's got something, certainly a talent. Couple of games, big games as well in the Europa League to talk about. Charlie, Motherwell, I tipped them to finish third in the table. They've had a dreadful start. I mean, I looked at the stats, Charlie. 2 points from 15 this season. He's only won 3 in 17 league and cup games. In 2020, Motherwell have just collapsed.
Yeah, they have, and I was excited about watching Motherwell this year. They've got a few young players that interest me, that potentially got a good chance coming to England. I was interested to see how Turnbull would come back from that injury and how he's reacted to the move to Celtic, and he's come back and hit the ground running. So he looks like he's going to move, which will be a big blow for them. So Motherwell were a team that everybody thought high hopes for, but they're just not produced at the moment, and they need to find a solution to try and win them some games soon.
Yeah, and of course the thing that's really kind of at the moment being the main talking point is David Turnbull. Will he play or not for Mullis? Certainly didn't train, and I think this is just a situation where the manager's trying to deflect away from the David Turnbull situation and talk about the big game in the Europa League against Glentoran. But he was praising the player, although not letting the cat out of the bag where he's going next.
I have no idea where we're at this moment in time, so unfortunately I can't help you, so you can ask as many questions as many ways possible. You'll try. I have no idea. I've literally just walked in the door from training. I think it's like, as a player, to everyone, not just to me, he's a top talent, one of the best talents I believe Scotland will have produced, and no matter where he is, he will be that talent. So I can't sing his praises high enough in terms of his mentality and his talent.
Let's be honest about it. Let's cut to the chase here. I love Stephen Robinson. I've got high regard for him, but managers who say they don't know exactly what's happening is just a lot of nonsense.
What's going on? Was it me you were talking to? And you cut out there.
Tom, it is you. I was just saying, managers who don't want to talk about a player that we all know is leaving, and he says he doesn't know where it's at, it's just a lot of nonsense. They do know.
Yeah, they do know. I think he's been kept up to date with everything that's going on, Peter. And I think David Turnbull will move to Celtic. I think he'll go. I think there was obviously a real shame for the lad the last time that he was on the brink of signing for Celtic, and they found something in his knee. I believe Neil Lennon is a huge fan of him, and Celtic have come back in for him again. So, as Charlie said, he's hit the ground running. You know, the last couple of games, you know, I've watched the highlights. He's been Motherwell's best player. I really, really like him. I think he's a top, top player. And I think he's a guy at 21 years old who can go on and be a real Celtic great if he signs for the club. So I think, you know, Robertson will be looking to sign him and then get the money in before the end of the window. And as you said, strengthen the squad, because there's nothing worse if they lose him a week before the window closes. And he's not got time to bring anyone in. It could cost him his job, to be honest.
Yeah, that's the strange thing about it, Charlie. He's got talent there. Lots of good young players. They are now starting to get that conveyor belt of people that seem to come through at Motherwell and get an opportunity to play. But the pressure's starting to crank up now. The more they go on and not get results, they dominated against Hamilton, suddenly, bang, caught in the last few minutes.
Yeah, and that's the way you've got to be in football. Motherwell obviously are a club that produce players, you know, over the years. They've sold big for big numbers, and, you know, £2 million, £3 million. So this is a big move. From fair play to Celtic for going back in for the lad as well, from what he's been through. But it'll be an interesting one, this game for Motherwell. I think if they can get through this and get winning games and try and build some momentum through it, then it'll be good for them.
Yeah, I'll tell you one thing, Roughie. They've got to win, because Scottish football, yeah, out with Celtic and Rangers, if you look back over the last decade,
it's been poor.
They can't even get to the group stages, Roughie. It's not been poor, Tam. It's been embarrassing.
Yeah, a lot of the scores have been embarrassing, and they're all guilty of it. The St Johnstones, the Aberdeens, and Motherwell as well. You know, and I think the galling thing for the Motherwell manager has been, Motherwell were a top three team last year with it, the boy Turnbull. You know, and he'll be trying to get his head around that. You know, how are the rest of the players, you know, failing to live up to what they lived up to last year? So that'll be a problem for him as well. But this is a must-win. They have to win this game. And unfortunately, obviously, there are no supporters there. But again, it's a must-win for me.
Yeah, I mean, listen, if you start to lose games to the likes of Glen Torren, Tam, you know, no disrespect to the Irish League, but the game's a bogey. I always think right now, Tam, and I'm not talking down our game. You're talking about the last 3 or 4 years. We've come from a low, low point, and we're starting to slowly come out on an upward curve, and it's a slow upward curve. Our game was in the gutter. The standing of it was poor. Out with Celtic, the clubs haven't had the spending power. We've been financially strapped. And I think slowly but surely we're trying to get out of it. But we're a long way from what we were 10, 20 years ago, 10 years ago, when Charlie was strutting his stuff in a Rangers strip. The calibre of player we were watching was way above what we're watching now.
Yeah, as Peter, I think that's obviously all due to money. You know, there's a lot more money swirling about back then. You know, I played in the early 2000s myself at Hibs, and, you know, Hibs Hearts were very strong, Dundee United were strong, Celtic Rangers were really, really strong and doing well in the Champions League every year. So there's no the same kind of money, but, you know, if Motherwell don't beat Glen Torren tomorrow night, it would be an absolute embarrassment. It would be shameful, to be honest. And I know that's putting more pressure on Motherwell. I don't care. Motherwell need to go out there and win that game. There's absolutely no doubt about it. Because if they get beat off of Glen Torren, then our game will be, people will be down south and all other places will be laughing and saying, you know, the game's a bogey up here. So Motherwell need to win. No excuses. You know, go out and beat Glen Torren.
Yeah, Ian Miller says Glen Torren will beat Motherwell. Ian, I'm not going to contradict you on it on our YouTube channel. It's all about opinions. Charlie, that is the key to it all is, you know, even when Aberdeen got a late run under Jimmy Calderwood in the UEFA Cup, everybody was on a high. They wanted them to do well. We've just been starved of it because, apart from anything else, in England, you can get a situation where a team gets, you know, may well have a couple of bad results in Europe or over a couple of seasons, but they go through a learning curve on how to play European football. We don't have that luxury up here, Charlie. Some of the clubs don't know how to play it, don't know how to get through the games.
They don't, and that's the type of player that you've got, and the using your the nous that you have in the games and how to play European-style football. You know, you can't always just go gung-ho and chase a game and run around like headless chicken. At times you need to just sit and wait, like Rangers have done extremely well under Steven Gerrard, that sometimes they know in the game they won't have the ball all the time. But as long as the defence, they're disciplined and the structure's right, on the break you can counter-attack or set plays, you can make a difference. And I think that's where the more times you play in Europe for Hibs, your Motherwells, they'll become better at it. And you know, hopefully tomorrow Glentoran could, you know, be an easy win for Motherwell and they can get into the next round. And Aberdeen obviously can beat this Faroe Islands team.
Yeah, I mean, listen, Aberdeen should trounce them. Runavik, Tam, with all due respect, this should be a case of Aberdeen going out there and just getting the comfortable win. Everybody seems to be fit, apart from obviously Sam Cosgrove. So they should be able to go out there and put on a performance and just think about hopefully getting a half-decent draw in the next round.
Yep, that's honestly, it's as good as a bye for Aberdeen. This team are rotten. You know, Hibs absolutely destroyed them 2 or 3 years ago. You know, yeah. Hibs battered them. Aberdeen should be taking 3 or 4 off them tonight. Part-time Faroe Islands team at home. You know, go and get 3 or 4 goals and get yourself a game time and get in the next round.
Yeah, I noticed Ash Taylor said in the press today, Runavik deserve respect. You know, Roughie.
Come on.
Roughie.
It's Roughie, nothing fatal.
Roughie, I don't care. No, I don't care what journalists asked him the question. Of course players respect teams that they come and play against. But we should be looking at an Aberdeen and saying, go out there, do your job, get it done and move on. There should be no excuses, as Tam said on this. I wouldn't be dismissive on saying, you know, I'm not going to be derogatory towards Runavik. I'm just saying Aberdeen need to do the job and get on with it. No excuses.
Yeah, they have to make it easier for themselves rather than make it hard for themselves. They have to go about it right for the start. Obviously, an early goal would help that, but they have been known Aberdeen to sort of a struggle through these games. Let's hope that's not the case. I'm not going to disrespect them. So I think Derek would be happy with 3-0 and that would be a good result to move on.
Yeah, let's leave Tam just disrespecting everybody. We'll kind of tread a fine line.
Come on.
Because
I
agree with Tam. I says the only respect that you show this team is winning 4-5, 6-0. That's the only respect you have to show them. You know, let's be honest, they're part-time footballers. It's no disrespect as in, you know, but the big thing is you don't take the top teams won't take the foot off the gas. You know, if you go 2 or 3 nil up and you start seeing 1 or 2 players then showboat and tricks and all that, that's being disrespectful. But if you go and win 4-5-0, Aberdeen done the job. That's the respect that the Faroes team, part team, should be doing. Move on to the next one and hopefully they can get through that.
Yeah, because you look at the coefficient and Celtic and Rangers are the only ones who are putting those points up. You know, our standing as a footballing nation, I think, would be helped enormously if we could somehow get to a point where, you know, for a 2 or a 3 year period, and I know it's very difficult, Tam, but even for a two, I think the maximum some clubs in Scotland can hope for outside Celtic and Rangers is a 2 to 3 year period tops, where they can keep a crop of special players together. I think it's even more difficult. I'm being kind saying 3. I think if you get 1 and 2 years with a special group of players and you can get a wee run together, finish third, then get a European situation, you're very lucky.
Yeah, yeah. Listen, the money down south, you know, Charlie knows this himself. You know, that's unbelievable, the astronomical money down in England. And, you know, £1 million, £2 million, £3 million, nothing to clubs in the Premiership or the Championship. You know, it's money down the side of the couch. So, you know, it's hard to keep good teams together in Scotland. You know, I've played in a few good teams up myself, and, you know, the Hibs team that we all come through together was cherry picked. So it's difficult to keep a team together, but, you know, try and enjoy it. And, you know, and hopefully, you know, there's a few young boys coming through at Motherwell, at Hibs, and different clubs, Aberdeen, and, you know, you just want them to go out and do well and maybe, you know, keep them together for a couple of seasons and put a challenge together.
Yeah, absolutely. Charlie, how did you find, was there a difference in the way the press deal with you down south to the way you're dealt with up here? You know, in press conferences and on a one-to-one basis, is there a vast difference? It's not a loaded question. It's just leading us nicely onto the Harry Maguire situation. But before you answer it, Charlie, I can tell you Martin Boyle has agreed a new contract until the summer of 2023 at Hibs. I'm really pleased to have signed my new contract. It's no secret what the club means to me and my family. So Tam, sum up how big a deal that is for Hibs to get him on a couple-year deal.
It's a massive, you know, great news for Hibs and the supporters. You know, Martin's been tremendous for two or three seasons at Hibs. I think a lot of Hibs supporters had resigned to him leaving, you know, maybe going to Celtic or testing himself down in the English Championship. To get him the new deal, it just adds to the feel-good factor at Hibs. And, you know, I'm delighted, and I'm sure the Hibs supporters will be delighted. Jack Ross will be delighted. He's a big figure in the dressing room as well as being on the park. And brilliant news. Delighted.
Yep. Good piece of news there. Charlie, I was talking about the press and the relationship. How did you... Were there major differences?
Yeah, absolutely. When you obviously I played at Rangers, so I was in a goldfish bowl, and you know, everything was scrutinised. But you know, the press, you don't see the press. You know, it's only really the local media that you speak to every other week. Really, it's not the big press. Don't really do big interviews, apart from, you know, like at Rangers and Celtic, every week there's somebody up, you put up to speak to them. So the press in Scotland is different. You know, when you're a Rangers Celtic player, you are in a goldfish bowl, and they need stories. And obviously, we're going to go into the Harry Maguire thing. He's just got himself in a situation where, you know, he's been unlucky, because I don't think the story is as true as everybody thinks it is.
I'm glad you said that, by the way, because obviously, as far as the Harry Maguire story is concerned, you know, when you look at the situation here, he's been found guilty of bribery, aggravated assault, resisting arrest, and there's a 21-month suspended sentence suddenly being handed out to him. Now, I, just reading between the lines on this one, I think, you know, being in a different country, different set of police, different set of circumstances, still a high-profile player who's left himself wide open to whatever fracas happened, but I don't think his end of the story has come out just yet. Manchester United have successfully lodged a full retrial to be held. They've just confirmed that in a statement. And that's the key element of this, Charlie. I think, you know, down south, they're calling for him. He's out of the England squad. They're now calling him for him to be stripped of the Manchester United captaincy. I don't know about you, but what's your take on it? I think it's ridiculous.
I think it's embarrassing that people are actually shouting for him to be stripped of the captaincy. The England one, I understand. I do understand it, that, you know, it's just the verdict has just come. I think it's time now for him to reflect with his lawyers and Manchester United. And, you know, these two games for England are, you know, it's good for him to keep away and get ready for the start of the season. But to be called stripped for the captaincy, I think there is, like I said before, more to the story. I think he's been stitched up. And, you know, the reports that are hearing about the bribery, you know, when you're earning 180, 200 grand a week and you're in a situation where you think you're getting mugged or your sister's been supposedly drugged, then of course you'd be able to pay to get out of the situation. So I think there's more to it. And how they've done the court case so quick is a massive issue as well for Manchester United and him. So I hope the lad, the truth comes out, and, you know, he's not guilty, because it's not in his demeanour as people I spoke to. He doesn't seem that type of person. And, you know, we'll see how it goes.
Yeah, interesting times. As ever, Roughie, you know what it's like yourself. You were at the heart of one of the biggest scandals when you were away with Scotland in 78. Sometimes a story can gather pace and the truth, you know, is left well behind.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to start knocking journalists the way I do, but I think the most of the problem that we had over there wasn't the sports journalists that were reporting in, and it was the news journalists who were sent over there, as Charlie said, to get a story. And sometimes when you have to get a story, sometimes it doesn't come out the way that it should come out. You know, I listened to the news last night, the BBC News, and that was all they were talking about, was taking the captaincy off him, you know, this and that and everything, and he hadn't even been found guilty yet. You know, it just, the media play on it, that's what they're there for. They're there to build up stories. But as Charlie said, there's two sides to every story. And unless you were physically there when it all happened, then you're just taking a hit.
Yeah, sorry, Roughie. I wasn't talking about the media. I was talking about the fact that he has been tried in a different country with, you know, a story that his side of it hasn't really come to the fore yet. media, you're part of the media, by the way. I always have to remind you of it. Yeah. But again, I'm not talking about the way they're portraying this. I mean, the opinions that are coming out for him to be stripped of the captaincy, I don't agree with. Certainly at the Man United level, I think what Charlie says about taking people out of the fire of an England game for a couple of games is understandable. They don't want him to become the main issue, but no, it's not about how the media deal with it. It's how he's being treated and how his case is going to be treated when he gets back to the appeal situation with it, and whether the truth actually does come out. All these things, Stefano Milano says, kangaroo court. Possibly. Stefano, who am I to argue with you? That's the joys of football and being a footballer. I don't know about you guys, I don't know if any of you have said it yourself, but when they were reading out the transcript of what he apparently said, do you know who I am? I don't know, Roughie. Have you ever been in the queue?
Nobody's ever said that.
Have you ever been in the queue, Roughie, at a nightclub?
Nonsense.
Do you know who
never.
I am?
No, I would never have done that. Never.
No.
You'd probably say
absolutely not. Well, of course, because Roughie was up in Inverness with his mate.
Yeah,
and they opened the door and went, you're still not getting in.
Yeah.
Shut the door. Yeah. Charlie, have you ever said, do you know who I am?
I'd love to have been able to throw his line out, do you know that I'm rich? I'd love to have thrown that out.
well, again, that's obviously conjecture. Charlie, I don't think anybody's. I cannot think of a footballer who said, "Do you know who I am?"
Listen, I've never heard it. You know what? And this is the big lads, the top players. They don't say that. It normally comes from lads that are playing in the League One, League Two level, that are probably not earning what they should be, and they have a little bit about them. That's what you get. You have that, but I would never expect somebody at the top level to say that. They don't need to. Do you know what I mean? Because they could back it up with whatever they've got.
Yeah, the best story I heard, Tam, was from Danny McGrain, who is just great company on any night out. And Danny said they were in a nightclub. I think it might have been in Hamilton with Charlie Nicholas. And Charlie at the time was the man. He was wearing all the trendy gear. He was a right good-looking boy. As a footballer, he had nobody that could actually beat him in the Premier League. He was fantastic for Celtic. And this guy, as Charlie's just mentioned there, a lower league player came up who was clearly unhappy that Charlie was in the nightclub, you know, being Jack the Lad. And he said, you, Nicholas, he said, I could do anything you can do. He said, I'm just as good as you, and you're, you know, poncing about here as if you're the bee's knees. And Charlie says, you can do anything I can do. And he said, yeah. And Charlie took out a £20 note and ripped it up and went, can you do that? and Danny McGrain says, the guy left with his head between his tail, and he says, I kid you not, he says, Charlie, quickly get the £20 and sellotape it all back together. He says, because it's just Charlie's patter was magnificent. Can you imagine that, Tom? He'd just go on your head down, wouldn't you?
Aye, just done the boy in, isn't he? Just up the road, fish supper, taxi. Hey.
Yeah, absolutely. Listen, we've got to go, but I've got to say we've got lots of things that we've been talking about today. Of course, good luck to Celtic, Aberdeen and Motherwell. We'll feature Aberdeen and Motherwell tomorrow ahead of their Europa League game again. Also, I think the big news, Martin Boyle for Hibs, 2-year deal to 2023. That's great news for the Hibbies. Give us your thoughts on that as well. And of course, we will keep across all the comings and goings at all your clubs and give you no shortage of opinion. The big news for everyone, I think, that we're hanging on to, Roughie, two things have happened in the last 24 hours that are significant here, Roughie. One is you can now play tennis indoors. Doubles, Roughie. Suddenly, we're back. We are able to play tennis again, Roughie.
I'm just wondering if Tam's got a partner and Charlie there. You know, I'm just, Charlie's not jumped in yet. He's lost his partner.
I'm available.
Oh, that's there good you news. Go.
I've
sent my racket back. Got my money back. Honestly, I did.
Did you? No, did you?
Put that racket on furlough, innit?
£40.
Charlie, brilliant. Racket's on furlough. I have to say, that's the first thing. And the second thing before we go, Tam, You're back playing five a-sides, which is great news. How did you go? Were you okay?
Oh, I was blowing a gasket last night. I've played with some decent players. John McStay, David Gray, Guy X-Pros, a couple of other guys that play junior, younger boys. Oh, I was really short. My shooting was terrible, which obviously not much has changed.
Not changed.
Great to be back out getting a kick of it, to be honest.
Brilliant. Oh, absolutely.
The five a-sides were mobbed.
Yeah, absolutely. I cannot wait to get back to the fives, get back to the ten. It's going to be fantastic. And of course, now that Charlie's declared himself, we'll need to phone the number six and tell him he's not wanted.
Yes.
He's bombed. Anyway, on that note, he shall not. So, Roughie, join us if you can tomorrow. Thanks for watching.
Expect the best used car deals guaranteed. Visit Arnold Clark.